Well, you won't be able to carry out your repairs here,
no. No.
Some sort of celebration, isn't it?
I don't quite know. You just listen, my dear, listen. Yes, I've seen that place before.
What do you think they're celebrating?
Well, as far as I can remember, I've seen them behave in a fashion like that on a former occasion.
What was that?
The relief of Mafeking.
Direction point! Direction point!
A Doctor Who podcast network.
Well, hi, everybody, and welcome back to Doctor Who Literature, the podcast taking you through the world of the Doctor Who novelizations put out by Target Books from 1973 onward in publication order. We're a member of the Direction Point Doctor Who Podcast Network. My name is Jason, and I'm your host on this journey, this very long journey. Welcome back to week three of our Key to Time month. We are covering Doctor Who and the Power of Kroll by Terence Dix from May 1980, the third of four straight Key to Time novelizations that came out in four consecutive months that year. My co-host, my guest this week, is the great Iain Martin, who you know from several other different Doctor Who podcasts, including a very popular and fairly new Doctor Who books podcast, which Iain and I will talk about very, very shortly on the other side of the break. I am recording this on New Year's Eve, a little more than an hour before the ball drops in Times Square. Yes, I did go into Manhattan today. However, I did not stay in Times Square to watch the ball drop. As a lifelong New Yorker, I have never done that, and I don't really have any motivation to do so. Watching it on television is quite enough for me. Earlier, you heard a clip from Doctor Who, The Daleks' Master Plan, Episode 8, the 1966 New Year's Day Special. Also, Episode 8 of the Dalek story, there's Daleks and the Meddling Monk. But for me, it always counts as Doctor Who's first New Year's Special. Since it is a holiday week, I will keep this introduction very brief. My thanks to all of you who are downloading and listening to this on the very first day of 2023. 2023 promises to be a very big year for Doctor Who. We've recently seen a 60-second teaser trailer released on Christmas for the three David Tennant specials that will air much later this calendar year. We are looking forward again to a full year of the Doctor Who Literature podcast. 52 weeks to the year means we should be covering almost 52 books. And of course, I will continue to co-host the Trap One podcast, and I will promote all the great content on Trap One on this show whenever and wherever I can. And I will also plug any appearances that I am invited to do on other podcasts, including an appearance that I have upcoming with Iain Martin, which we'll talk about on the other side of the break. Once again, I want to wish a very happy and healthy new year, a very happy and healthy 2023. Doctor Who's Diamond Anniversary, 60th Anniversary Year. Let's get to it.
They all say, who is Doctor Who?
Do you collect Doctor Who? Do you have Doctor Who items and you don't know that you collect Doctor Who? For all things in the Doctor Who collecting world, tune in to the Doctor Who Collectors Podcast, a Direction Point Network podcast. I am Larry Van Mersbergen, your host, and I have been collecting Doctor Who for 41 years. We have popular features like collection protection and the most outrageous offer anywhere you get your podcasts. You're listening to Doctor Who Literature, and whatever you do, keep turning the pages.
All right, so my next guest is the host or co-host of not one, not two, but I believe three different podcasts, and I'm getting dizzy just trying to figure out how he is able to juggle all of this together and still have time to make a guest appearance on my show. Iain Martin, welcome to Doctor Who Literature.
Oh, thank you for having me. It's very rare that I get to sit in front of a microphone, so this is a real treat for me.
I want to point out for the uninitiated that we are doing this back to back. I just did an episode of one of your shows, and we spent an hour talking about the very lush, very rich, very evocative and atmospheric 2002 Doctor Who novel Camera Obscura by the great Lloyd Rose, the American writer. We're going from that to talking about The Power of Kroll. So there's a very audible thud in between the recording for your show and recording for my show. So to delay the inevitable, let's talk instead about you. Walk us through your three different shows and how much of a pleasure it is for you to juggle all this podcasting work.
Oh, wow. Okay. Well, so I'm going to transport you back to the very early days of lockdown, 2020, not a lot's going on. And obviously, everyone who didn't already have a podcast in the Western world decided to start a podcast in lockdown. My old friend Mark got in touch with me, Mark from the what had been the Blue Box podcast years and years ago. And he said, do you want to do a show where we watch all of Doctor Who in order? Like, that's never been done before. But I thought about it, and I had there are large chunks of Who that I hadn't really seen or gone back to. So I thought that would be interesting. And, you know, very quickly, All of Time and Space was born, and that's we're just about to start recording Patrick Troughton's second season. So we're plowing through that. I set up my Doctor Who Books podcast, We're All Stories in the End, sort of last summer in what I can only describe as a moment of madness, really. When I moved from the UK to the US, all my books and all my property stayed in the UK for about 7 months because of Brexit, basically. So when my new adventures finally arrived, I was able to really fetishistically arrange them on the shelves and dust them and talk to my beauties. And I'd found a couple of EDAs in secondhand bookshops around here. And I just thought, A, I'm going to start collecting these, but to justify that, I need a B. So why don't I put together a very hastily thought out podcast where I get lots of people to help me discuss all these books in, I would say, far too much detail, and giving far too much time to each book. So that's what I'm doing, and that's going to occupy me for the next 10 years. I've also recently become a part of Strangers in Space, and I do a comedy podcast called The Electric Sodcast with my old best friend from the UK, whose name is James. He's not very well.
So I'm actually behind the times then. You are actually now are part of a fourth podcast in addition to your other three.
Yeah, So in February of this year, I got a job as a professional podcast producer within a publishing house. And so I started doing a few bits and pieces as kind of practice for my day job. But now, obviously, my hobby is now my day job. And I try and fit in work around my Doctor Who podcasting commitments. It might not be worth as much money as what I do professionally, but I think the world needs it.
The world needs more Doctor Who books, podcasts, and as somebody who started one during the pandemic, I certainly sympathize.
It needs more middle-aged white men talking about Doctor Who books from their childhood, I think. The beauty of these podcasts is people aren't really listening to this because they want to hear about what happens in the Doctor Who book we're talking about. By the time they've bought into your show and they listen episode after episode, it's like listening to a friend. It's like hanging out with friends. So the way I approach these podcasts is just to make something that's entertaining and fun, rather than something that's necessarily rigorously analyzing the very deep and very complex plots available to us.
And you're waving a copy of The Power of Kroll, which if you were to put The Power of Kroll novelization on Jupiter, it would weigh probably an ounce.
Yeah, it's a slim volume, isn't it?
It's not even close to Terence Dix's slimmest, which is the funny part. But I'll just say that I've come around to your way of thinking. When I was looking for a solo podcast to do, and I'd already been a part of the Trap One podcast, and I'm now an official co-host on that. Then I drifted in and out as an occasional guest on other podcasts over the years. When the time came to have my own, I immediately dipped into my back catalog because I have written extensively about the novelizations elsewhere, so I decided to take my writings and spin those into a podcast. Then after 4 episodes of me doing forensic examinations of the books, I realized that I needed a little bit more. So our mutual friend Ross, his show The Runcible Report, where he and Jeff talk about a topic but weave in and out and have side conversations and tangents, that was much more inspirational to me because I was discovering their show at about the time that I was launching mine. So now my conversations take up most of the show and they're a lot more free form, and we don't talk about the book certainly for the full hour. We could probably read The Power of Kroll start to finish and it wouldn't take an hour. So
I was going to say exactly that.
Other things have to fill the void, and we're also going to play a trivia game at the end of the hour here, so hold on to your hat and get ready to see if you can outwit me at 20 questions.
Oh my lord. Wow.
But I will say that every time I look at your Twitter photo for the All Stories in the End podcast, which is the collection of NAs and EDAs interspersed, I feel that the surge of adrenaline that I would get in the 1990s when I would go into the bookstore and try and find the NAs on the sci-fi wall because of the distinctive white covers with the pastel print. I still have dreams to this day of standing in a bookstore with my head cocked to the side, trying to identify the novelizations or the missing adventures or the new adventures from their spines. And when I see the spines of the books on your photo, it brings me all the way back to those happy days of trying to find Doctor Who books in the wild in the bookstore, which is an experience that is now lost to us because Doctor Who books are not nearly so prevalent, and now we can do most of our ordering online. So those random whimsical trips to the bookstore trying to find a copy of White Darkness or Camera Obscura or Dark Progeny or Set Piece, those days are behind us.
That's very true. I mean, I was going to say presumably it's never been as easy over here as it was, you know, back in the UK. But even then, I think by the end of the David Tennant era, all those big chunky new adventure hardback things they were publishing then just kind of disappeared. And now I imagine bookstores carry very few, if any, Doctor Who books. So it's a real kind of badge of honor that says we were there back in the day. These were our books. This was our religion. These were ours, you know, and not just us, but people. As I discover every episode, there are people that have got into the books more recently. People still love them, whether or not they're right to, I don't know, but they do.
And there's a thriving secondary market thanks to eBay and Facebook where people are actually chasing down copies of the books because they weren't there in the 90s and they want to read them now 30 years on. And they are buying copies off folks who have outgrown their copies. So, you know, westward the wagons across the sands of time, the patterns are rebuilding themselves. I will say that I recently submitted a brief audio essay for your All Stories episode on Blood Harvest, the Terrence Dicks 1994 new adventure, bringing us back full circle to the man of the hour, Terrence Dicks, on this show. But I decided to go back into the RecArts Doctor Who archive on Google and find my posts about Blood Harvest from 1994. Turns out that I didn't get the book for 6 months because there was a problem with the distributor and the books were kind of drying up in the States already by 1995, before the TV movie, before the NAs lost their license and became a Benny only series. So even by 1995, I was having trouble getting the books, and I read Blood Harvest 6 months after everybody else. And my review of the book, 90% of it is complaining about the distribution and 10% is talking about the book. I was hoping I could just take my old review and read it out in audio essay form for you and not do any work. But as it turns out, I had to weed through all the chaff to find the wheat. And the wheat was terrible because I was a very sophomoric writer when I was 21 years old, come to find out. So that's an all-new original essay that you are going to be hearing when your Blood Harvest episode comes out. Very little taken from the RecArts Doctor Who archives.
In many ways, that's a shame. I mean, the international distribution of books is very germane to my interests, and it would have been fascinating to hear about your trouble from the mid-90s. But I suppose to the the average listener, it would have been, dare I say, irrelevant. So you were quite right, I think, to edit yourself there.
And I was coming to your essay from a point of view that I don't think anyone else is going to have, because I'm coming to this from a Blood Harvest positive standpoint. So I come out on the RH positive factor for Blood Harvest. Insert rimshot and groaning sounds here.
Yes, that's a niche standpoint. It's also a terrible joke.
I specialize in two things on the show, Iain. Niche standpoints and terrible jokes. That's literally my base.
That's what we're here for. Brilliant. Right. Now, as long as I know, then I can join in. But yeah, I mean, Blood Harvest was, and I can say this on here because it'll be out soon enough. I lose track of who shows out when. It's all very timey-wimey. But Blood Harvest was a divisive book in the same way that I think pretty much all Terence Dicks books are in the sort of Virgin and EDA era. For some reason, the man who got our generation reading, or certainly in my country, he pretty much single-handedly got the entire male half of the country reading. And I think in my primary school, there was two girls who read Doctor Who books as well. So that ratio may be different now. Who knows? But yeah, by the early 90s, I don't know. It's like the magic kind of dried up.
What helps in the novelizations is that he has a very limited word count, and he has to choose his words with precision. So even though we'll talk about this over the rest of the hour, Power of Kroll is a weak, at least from my humble point of view, TV story, and it doesn't have a whole lot to recommend it. When Terence takes it in book form, he is distilling Robert Holmes's ideas down to their purest essence. What he does is, in his own inimitable and unmistakable way, is Terence Dix takes these poorly staged action sequences on TV and turns them into breathless prose, because he never uses words of more than three syllables. He never does a run-on sentence. His writing is begging to be read aloud because it is poetry and music to the ears. When it comes to the 90s and he's writing books that are double the length, he kind of loses his brevity is the soul of wit. And some of those books, he struggles to find enough plot to fill out 250 pages. For his year 2000 EDA, which fell in the middle of the Caught on Earth arc, I think that book came in 50 pages short, and Justin Richards had to write some extra material himself to get it to minimum length.
Wow.
But what I like about Blood Harvest, and I realize this is probably sacrilegious, Terence is writing about what he loves. He's writing from his own pop culture standpoint. So there's a quote from Nelson Algren, who is a writer who's not too well remembered these days. There's an awful lot of Raymond Chandler, who's one of clearly his favorite writers. He's doing a sequel to State of Decay, which is one of his best TV stories, and he's doing a sequel to Five Doctors, which I'm not positive that Five Doctors isn't the best classic series story of all time. I'm working on that theory. And when I get to my Five Doctors episode in a few months, I'll put that to a stress test. But I think Five Doctors is the GOAT for the classic series. So he's sequelizing two very good stories and telling a story about mob Al Capone era Chicago and the St. Valentine's Day Massacre and bootlegging. He's clearly having a ball writing this book. And if you go back and read these 1994 reviews from all the big names on RecArts at the time, people really liked the Chicago stuff. They tolerated the vampire stuff, and they hated the Gallifrey stuff, sequel to the Five Doctors stuff. I think the book has aged pretty well. A lot of those NAs are written by young authors in their early 20s who are learning how to write a novel. And many of them have gone on to hugely successful careers and other things, but a lot of these books suffer from first novel syndromes and run-on sentences and purple prose. Terence doesn't have that problem. So when you're reading the books now with a critical eye 25 years later, then you're no longer a sophomoric college student reading a book a month. I think his stuff actually has aged remarkably well versus some of the other authors in the line. And I'm sure that's still a minority view, but I want to give a shout. I think he's doing very good work in Blood Harvest. and I don't think it got enough appreciation. So hopefully my little review on your Blood Harvest episode will turn the tide, maybe.
Well, let's hope so. but yes, it was a jolly jape of a book, and let's move on. Otherwise, we're just going to spend your whole show talking about a different Terence Dicks book, and that would be terrible. That said, obviously, there, we don't have too much to talk about with this pamphlet. So, you know, I'm open to any diversions or cul-de-sacs you want to go down.
So let's talk a little bit more about All of Time and Space. What distinguishes your Watching Doctor Who in Order podcast from any other podcast which watches Doctor Who in order? What is your unique selling point?
So the most obvious comparison is Flight Through Entirety. We are not for Australian flamboyant gay men eating cake. We're just sort of two sad, fat, heterosexual, failed straight guys with no cake at all.
I want to say that is the best advertisement for Flight Through Entirety that I've ever heard, and I'm going to cut that out and send it to them as a bumper.
I think they'd absolutely love that. No, their show, which I only got into after we started doing our show, but their show's full of kind of learning and opinion, and it's got some very funny bits, and it's just a really well put together, very clever show. What we try to do, and I'm frantically trying to couch this in terms that make it sound like it's an artifice, but we try and present a more straightforward, you know, not very critically astute, not very intelligent kind of approach. I mean, Mark is an excellent host, and he's able to just pick out those things that make for really good conversations. And I just sort of chip in with witless remarks, and I do a quiz that no one ever understands or gets. And, you know, we have a lot of fun. But it's going to be a long marriage, Mark and I, doing that show. I mean, we're probably looking at another 10, 15 years of that. I don't know.
That's one of the reasons why this is a weekly show. If I were to do 160 books once a month, it would take me 15 years to get to the Paradise of Death. And when I am on Medicare, I do not still want to be thinking about the Paradise of Death. So this is a limited project that will run out in about 3 years, and I think my audience will be much the happier when they're not trying to keep up with the weekly show anymore. But I'm trying to plow through this as best as I can. I will say that I did my Doctor Who pilgrimage on Twitter starting in 2020, the pandemic year, and I got through the entire classic series in 13 months, watching two parts of a story a night. So that was the fast version of All of Time and Space, but not nearly as entertaining as your podcast is.
Well, I did. So the I forgot what it was called there, that pandemic that we had, COVID, happened at the same time as BritBox launched in the UK. So that's when I was able to go back and watch. I wanted to watch The Full Circle, because that was the first story I remember watching on TV when I was tiny. So I watched Full Circle, and then I thought, well, I've got BritBox. I'm not going out very much, obviously, pandemic. I'll watch all of Tom. So I watched all of The Fourth Doctor, and I kept watching all the way up to Caves of Androzani Part 5, at which point, yeah, I struggled. So I was very keen when Mark said, let's go back to the beginning to do that. So it meant I didn't have to watch The Twin Dilemma.
I just received in the mail yesterday from the UK my Doctor Who The Collection Season 2 box set in the fancy, sturdy, hard cardboard UK release with the book.
Lovely.
Which has that fresh magazine page smell, as opposed to the cheap plastic USA DVD releases. So for season two, I could not wait, and I dived in last night to watch the supplementary material for Planet of Giants. And we'll eventually be covering that box set on the Trap One podcast. I've already got a terrific panel together for that one, me and three other guests. So for me, the classic, the black and white stuff is always going to be my home base with Doctor Who, even though I started not too far after you. I started with season 20. You started in season 18. But the black and white is almost my home, even though I wasn't alive when any of these stories were made and I was born during the color era. So how do you work it? If you get a new DVD release that is out of sequence for where you are in the podcast, do you defer the DVD until you get there in the podcast, or are you watching them in random order?
I don't really get DVDs of anything apart from missing stories that have been animated, and those I just sort of slot in as and when I need them. I'm not going to buy the DVD box or the Blu-ray. I should say Blu-ray because it's 2022 and I'm technical. I won't be getting the Blu-rays until they until I'm done with streaming, because I think Doctor Who's always going to be available. And from the sound of it, Disney are going to hopefully have all of Doctor Who's backlist and so on by this time next year. And I think that'll do me. It's not something that I feel like I really need to watch many more times in my life, but I'm probably wrong about that.
It's the supplemental material. It's the Chris Chapman stuff. It's the Toby Haydock stuff. It's the Paul Scoon stuff. It's the text commentaries on each story. It is the behind the sofa. Now, sadly, they do not have a behind the sofa on every single episode on this disc. There's no behind the sofa for Planet of Giants, for example. But Matthew Sweet did an hour-long interview with William Russell, which was recorded several years ago and is just being released now. There's a season two documentary elsewhere on the discs that I haven't reached yet. There's a Maureen O'Brien documentary on the disc that I haven't reached yet. There's a lot of good stuff on there. You could almost spend weeks working your way through the Blu-ray just going through the supplementary material and never watch the actual stories themselves.
I could do that, and that would be so fascinating. But, you know, I have four podcasts to make and a wife who will very soon, I think, snap and beat me to death with a saucepan if she has to hear the words Doctor Who again. So I have to try and operate under the radar.
And let's not forget the pesky matter of a day job, which helps support your podcasting empire.
Oh, that old nonsense. Sure.
So let's jump back in time a little bit and let's do your autobiography. You've told us that your first story is Full Circle. As two rapidly aging, middle-aged, heterosexual white men, sadly nattering on here without cake.
Hey.
How old were you when you discovered Doctor Who? When did it become your obsession? And how did you get into the novelizations? Let's have your Doctor Who autobiography in any order you see fit.
Okay, so I would have been about 4 or 5 when I saw Full Circle around my Auntie Janet's house. Full Circle Part One, I should specify. I've for years I've thought that was my first story, but I do remember like a clip of Megloss, and I do also remember the closing credits to season 17. So I must have been watching it in season 17 and all the way through, but for some reason, Full Circle in my heart. If you ask me what's the first story I saw, I'm going to say that one. I became obsessed with the show. So I think by the time the Fourth Doctor fell off the Pharos telescope, we then had a summer repeat season in the UK called The Five Faces of Doctor Who. And the first episode of that went out on a very memorable day for me. My primary school, so I'd have been 5, my school was next to a petrol station, and there was a leak at the petrol station, and they evacuated the whole school in case it blew up. So we had to spend about 3 hours on the school field in the rain. And I was telling everyone, oh, Doctor Who's on today, but it's like 100 years old. And I whipped myself up into such a frenzy of excitement that I went home and watched part one of Unearthly Child as a kid. But I was pretty much hook, line and sinker, head over heels in love with the show from that point on. I started getting the books at that point. I started getting the magazine a few years later. We didn't have a video recorder until Sylvester came. Well, maybe for late Colin, but I didn't need it then. So I was able to record some Sylvester stories. And when the show was, it wasn't cancelled, it was rested in 1989. I wasn't sulking, I was resting. And as soon as the books started coming out from Virgin, I was beating down the doors of my local bookshop with money in my hand, you know, saying, take this, give me more Sylvester and Sophie. I read all the new adventures every month, bought each book as soon as it came out, all the way through university. And they remain a really important part of my life and a set of memories, because they were very much about the 90s, and they were filled with pop culture references and musical references, and they are a kind of collage of everything that was happening in life in that era. And then the Eighth Doctor books came out, and they weren't terribly good, so I stopped reading them after about five books. I have of recent times got back into them, and I'm giving them a second chance, and I'm finding that I may have been initially very hasty to have bailed on the series when I did, but nevertheless, bail on it I did.
It's funny that you're describing a series of very specific cultural moments of time. I think we are the last generation that bridged the gap between black and white and color TV, because when I was growing up as a kid in the 70s, I had a black and white TV in my room. I was watching all my PBS shows, you know, Mr. Rogers' Neighborhood, Sesame Street, Electric Company, 3-2-1, Contact was just starting. I was watching all of that on a black and white TV. So when the black and white Hartnell and Troughton years came to the States in 85, I wasn't that too far removed from having a black and white 13-inch set in my room. So for me, black and white was a language that I understood. You saw Unearthly Child during the Five Faces of Doctor Who season, when that story is 18 years old. It was more recent to you than Friends is to the current generation of tweens watching Friends now, but Friends still feels contemporary, whereas Unearthly Child feels like an ancient bit that fell out of a time warp from the year 6 million BC, or as my mother would say, since the year Gimel. Because black and white is really not really a thing anymore, and you don't really have TV shows made in a very tiny studio space on a 1,000-pound budget. The visual language of Unearthly Child is now an acquired taste, whereas the visual language of Friends is the same as any other sitcom that you can get now on television or streaming. We are the last generation to whom Unearthly Child makes any sense, aren't we?
I think you're right. I'm just wondering if we got hold of a youth and we sat them down and we made them watch Unearthly Child and then Friends, whether the haircuts and the fashions of Friends might cause them slightly more distress than what was happening in Unearthly Child. I mean, I don't know. But you're right. We are the last generation that's got that kind of approach to TV. Remembering black and white stuff. We're also probably one of the last generations that's going to remember broadcast TV, because 5-10 years from now, I think everything will be streaming.
The idea of having to wait for a particular show to air, and if the power was out or the VCR didn't set, you would miss that and it wouldn't come around again for reruns for, you know, with Doctor Who another 2 years. I had very famous VCR malfunctions during The Five Doctors and during Legopolis, so it was years before I saw the last 5 minutes of The Five Doctors. And I'll tell the story when my Legopolis episode airs. We were out of town. We spent a week on vacation in Manhattan in the winter of 85 with my parents, my kid sister, my mother's sister, and her family. We all stayed in a fancy hotel in Manhattan. And that was the week Legopolis was airing four parts a night on PBS. I set the VCR. There was some malfunction so that I got half of the second half of part three of Legopolis and the first half of part four, but I didn't get all of part four. Must have been a problem with the PBS feed, and they showed everything at a delay. So for years, all I had of, again, this is the regeneration story that I was dying to see more than any other. Adric and Nyssa are in the console room. They're looking in. The Watcher disconnects the entire coordinate subsystem. He's taking us out of space and time altogether.
Yep.
They start shrinking into black and white on the screen. Power goes out. That's the end of the recording.
Oh, my God.
And it was 2.5 more years before I was able to see that again. Similarly, when I tried to tape The Rescue in 1987 off of PBS, I had a really bad VHS tape, and it recorded badly with the tracking off. And that was the only copy of The Rescue that I had for 2.5 years until that cycled around again. Trying to explain to my kid now what it was like when everyone in America had the same haircut, the Rachel. She doesn't know what I'm talking about. Trying to explain about taping shows, you know. Good, you know, you had to wait 2.5 years. Why not just press rewind? Why not just go back on streaming the next day? You know, it's a whole different ballgame.
It's like trying to explain something in a different language from a different universe, isn't it? Really, but yeah, I mean, I can't believe of all the stories your VHS messed you about, it chose Legopolis 4 to do that. I mean, that's cruel and unusual.
Wait till you hear where I was when the tape cut out on the Five Doctors. But I'll save that story for my Five Doctors episode, which is about 6 months from now.
Well, I'll look forward to that, and I imagine so will everyone listening.
And with the new adventures, the NAs, I mean, I was there at a very specific cultural moment because I joined Rec Arts in 1992, just as the first NA authors are joining the forum and posting. So you had Kate Orman, you had Paul Cornell, you had Andy Lane, you had Craig Hinton. Christopher H. Bidmead and Johnny Byrne both showed up from the classic series, and they were regular posters on Rec Arts for a while.
Wow.
So I can tell you all those Rec Arts Doctor Who posters who were turned into characters in the new adventures. I can tell you who they all are. And when you were buying Happy Endings and Return of the Living Dead, you were not aware that you were going to be talking to the guy who's briefly mentioned in those books on a podcast 30 years later.
Wow.
And when you were giving up on the lion in the middle of vampire science, you weren't aware that, hello, one of us was a major character in that book playing a vampire law student.
Wow. That's incredible.
It's funny that we discover the books at a very specific cultural moment. And part of my enjoyment of the NAs came from being there and seeing the authors previewing their work. When Lance Parkin joined Rec Arts Doctor Who and made a joke about Mel being in Just War, everyone assumed it was a typical Lance Parkin gag. Turns out he was dead serious.
It was a great moment in a decade of, I mean, everything else in the 90s was rendered into a footnote straight away as soon as you got Mel coming back in prose form. My word.
Not to mention the cover of Head Games. So what are your, give us five of your favorite NAs. What do you think are five of the best of the books on the line?
I'm going to have to do that thing where I look around over my shoulder because they're here and I can see them. Otherwise I forget. I think the three books by Andrew Cartmell are the best, not so much his first, but certainly, Warlock, which was set in Canterbury at pretty much the month I moved to Canterbury to go to university. The first Kate Orman novel is very memorable. I loved Conundrum at the time, but I don't think that's a book that benefits from sort of repeated readings anymore, sadly. And I remember a lot of good stuff in 96 when The Range got quite difficult to read. There was that whole Psi Powers arc that was possibly more confusing than brilliant. But
some of those books tried the patience, and then the Ben Aronovich hard drive malfunction, quote-unquote, that meant that book didn't come out for another year, and it came out in very truncated form and with a different author.
Mm, yes. But there was still some good books. And I have a very soft spot for happy endings. I know it's, as a piece of narrative fiction, it's somewhat wanting, but I read it in one go on a hot summer's afternoon during Euro 96, waiting for a football match. A couple of beers, it was a great day. And for that reason, and that reason alone, I'd have happy endings as well.
Kate Orman was on Rec Art, so when I got my copy of Left-Handed Hummingbird, I was emailing her every couple of pages, is that a reference to this? Is that a reference to that? So I was very lucky to have the inside scoop, so to speak. But I was a fan of the NAs even before that, because I had read Genesis and Exodus in late 1991, shortly after they came out, and I was enamored of them. Later had the privilege of interviewing John Peel about Time Warp Genesis for the Trap One podcast during the pandemic. So of the four lines, the NAs are the ones that have the most personal meaning for me. The EDAs I read with decreasing interest, and I kind of petered out towards the end of the line. But what amazes me is that I went back and I reread Camera Obscura out of sequence for the first time in 20 years for your show. And we just recorded that immediately before this. And I really loved it in a way that I don't even remember loving it in 2002. And I saw so much more that made sense now. I'm wondering if I go back and reread the entire Sabbath arc, if I wouldn't enjoy it a lot more now in 2022 than I did back in the day. So turning this back to you, I suppose we should pay some lip service to the focus of this week's episode. If you started watching the show at the tail end of season 17, middle of season 18, and that's when you became a fan, when would you have first seen and or read The Power of Kroll?
I believe that I didn't read the Target book when I was a kid. I didn't read all of them. I didn't have that, which is a ridiculous thing I'm about to say. I'm going to try and pretend I didn't have that kind of completist gene. I so clearly did. We're all OCD in this fandom. But I just didn't have the money to buy all the books. And as a 5, 6, 7, 8-year-old, I wasn't that enamored of the Fourth Doctor. I think the first time I saw Power of Kroll, therefore, would have been in about 2012. For some reason, I just bought the entire Key to Time series. I was living in Dubai at the time, and I was kind of feeling a bit homesick for the UK, so I was just picking up anything I could.
That's a way to bury the lead. Living in Dubai, that's a whole story in and of itself.
Just thought I'd sneak that in there under the radar. Yeah, 6 years I lived out there, and I did a lot of things out there that I'm doing again in my life now, sort of certain podcasts and certain kind of things that fill that homesickness hole that you have in you when you're away from, you know, your family and your home. You turn back to a lot of the same things. And it's interesting that you were saying you liked reading Camera Obscura a lot more now. I'm wondering if, on one level, if the EDAs are doing the same job now that they were doing 20 years ago. 20 years ago, they existed because the TV show had kind of gone away. And I think now, for a lot of people of our age, the TV show is really not aimed at us anymore. So I think a lot of people are turning back to these kind of books, just to get that kind of experience again.
I mean, obviously, it's a very small market share, but the Facebook groups that I belong to talking about the books, people are collecting these books with enthusiasm because either they were too young or they weren't paying attention back in the day. And somehow the NAs have now acquired the acronym VNAs, which makes no sense to me because I was there. We were never calling them the VNAs in the 90s.
No, it's very much the NAs.
But it's a whole secondary fandom that's popped up, and it's fascinating to watch, and it makes me want to go back and do a whole reread through from the beginning. I just no longer have the time, not to mention I'm reading a Target book a week for this podcast. So,
yeah, that's a big ask. But to answer your question, yes, I think it would have been about 2012 when I first watched the Key to Time series, and thus began my appreciation for Tom Baker.
Is The Power of Kroll a good story?
I'm going to say yes, it is. And I'm going to say that within certain narrow specific parameters, like it's a good story for a Doctor Who story. It's got a lot of things in it that children would absolutely love. It's got, you know, a very large monster. It's got men painted green. It's got mucking about in some marshes. There's a base that sooner or later may or may not be under siege. You've got one of the most butch and manly gun runners ever seen on television. And the fantastic bit with the being stretched out by the drying creepers. So in theory, you've got all the ingredients there for something that's going to live in the hearts and minds of children for all time.
Which begs the question, what went wrong? Why is the story so poorly regarded?
So I think what went wrong, they, you know, day one in the studio, they've gone to the producer, which I believe was Graham Williams at that point. They said, hey, Graham, we're going to start filming Power of Kroll now. Can we have, you know, the money for the sets and the costumes and the effects, you know, the production budget? And he would have said, now, lads, bit of bad news. I can give you the money that we put aside for this story. It's not worth as much as it was last week. Obviously this would never happen in Britain now, but Britain then was in the grip of a terrible inflation and fiscal disaster.
Or, as we say now in the throes of Brexit, the good old days.
Absolutely, 100%. What that island has chosen to do to itself, I find extraordinary. But yeah, so on a production level, I think the ambition of the story, slight though it was still too big for the BBC to realise 100% effectively.
Watching the show, doing the pilgrimage that I did during the pandemic, everything from the War Games episode 1 up through Horror of Fang Rock Part 4 clearly is a golden age of Doctor Who. Very few clunkers in that run. I have spent a lot of time on this podcast working through the problem that is Talons of Wang Chiang. I stubbornly enjoy the story, even though everything to the contrary tells me it should be consigned to history's dustbin. But it's so witty and so gorgeous to look at that I kind of force myself to ignore all the blatant problems with that story. And I'm not talking about the giant rat. Everything from War Games through Horror of Fang Rock is a thing of beauty and a joy forever. Then you get to Invisible Enemy Part 2, and the wheels fall off because Graham Williams just does not have Philip Hinchcliffe's magic producer's touch. And Robert Holmes is now phoning it in so badly you can hear the operator on the line in the middle of Invisible Enemy asking him to deposit 25 cents for the next 3 minutes. That's how badly he's phoning it in. So season 15 is a torture to watch in sequence, and you'll find that out in about 12 years when all of time and space gets there. Season 16 is a rallying point. Rebos Operation is one of the best things Robert Holmes ever wrote. Mary Tam hits her stride with Tom Baker in the middle of Pirate Planet, and the two of them become a wonderful team, and they didn't get nearly enough time together. By Armageddon Factor, they are finishing each other's sentences, and it's the best chemistry between a doctor and companion since Sarah Jane Smith several years earlier. The first four serials of Key to Time, I'm not crazy about Pirate Planet, but its heart is in the right place, and each one of those four stories is just delightful to watch as you're watching it. With Power of Kroll, Robert Holmes may be overextended doing two stories a year, and Norman Stewart as a director is no David Maloney, who's already off the show by this point. He's no Michael E. Bryan, who's already off the show by this point. He's no Douglas Camfield, who's off the show by this point. The acting quality is not as good. John Abernethy should have been playing Ram Dutt, He should have been playing Thawne. He should not have been playing Rankwin. He should not have been buried behind, plastic dreadlocks and green paint. He's one of the best character actors Doctor Who has. He's so good that Francis Ford Coppola puts him in The Godfather Part 3. He needs a better part than he was given. You put him as Ram Dahl, you have an all-time great story, but there's just so much that goes wrong. And I try to like Power of Kroll. I try and give it a fair shake every time, but I just cannot make it work in my head. And then Philip Madoc is wasted as well in a small part. So I think it is not Robert Holmes' best script, and I think the production lets it down in every possible way. I think we're not too far off the same page on that one, but tell me about the novelization. Does the novelization work in a way that the TV series doesn't quite? Because Terrence is not waiting for Graham Williams to give him a 25-pound check. Terrence Dix is not worried about budget cuts.
Yes. On the printed page, the story, as you say, when it's sort of pared down to its absolute minimalist prose, the story can really sing when you can't see the shortcomings of, you know, the realization of the monster or the sets or the awkward looking men with green thighs knocking about the place looking a bit shifty or Ram Dahl. It works really well. What I found fascinating, I haven't read a Target novel, I would say, in maybe 30 years. And I can remember getting four of them out of the library one Saturday and reading one of them in one sitting. And that being a really big deal when I was, you know, seven or eight. I read this in my lunch hour today. It took less than an hour. And it's amazing when you read something that fast, just how... So the story begins, and Thawne has come back from... He's been on some kind of work expenses trip back to Delta Magna. He's probably, you know, brought back a few dirty shirts and had some nice meals out with people from the company. I don't know. but he's fine. And the TARDIS lands and the Doctor and Romana come out, and that's all good. And then really very quickly, the whole thing just goes to hell and Thawne just falls apart. It's like someone's fired a starting pistol at the beginning of chapter one and said, right, go nuts as quickly as you can. And the whole thing just shoots along. And because it's bare knuckle prose, and you're just carried along really effectively, and the dialogue in particular with the Doctor and Romana is an absolute joy to reread.
And I'll be talking about this a little more on the back half of the show when I read out my review of the novelization, which I wrote in the summer of 2019, right before Terrence Dix passed away. Terrence finds the political subtext to the story, which I'm sure Robert Holmes intended. This is a bit of left-wing agitprop. It's nowhere to be found on TV. The TV just doesn't quite make the politics work. Maybe it's because of the direction. Maybe it's because of the acting. Maybe it's because John Leeson's character is very important but is kept in the background. They didn't want folks figuring out that Dagheen is really canine, and so they didn't give him enough to say. He's an important character. Terrence sets this right in the novelization, and he makes the politics of it much, much more visible.
There's also a very strange line where Romana's alluding to the politics of the situation, and the Doctor says, "Oh, don't talk to me about politics." And you think, surely that's one of your like biggest interests, because you land somewhere, you find a fascist government, and you depose it very quickly. You're clearly, you know, you'd be a bit of a keyboard warrior if you'd never left Gallifrey. You'd be on Twitter with all the other angry Time Lords whinging about the government.
And considering that Robert Holmes's two stories before this were the harshest takedown of capitalism that you will get outside of the pages of Karl Marx, and a story about a con man trying to swindle a fascist, politics is where Robert Holmes lives.
Exactly.
And this story wants to do that and just doesn't. And of course, it wasn't his idea to put the biggest monster Doctor Who had ever seen. That was foisted upon him. But maybe if he wasn't writing around Kroll, maybe the story could have been a lot more. I've heard it argued, and I don't quite buy it. I've heard it argued that Caves of Androzani is a rewrite of Power of Kroll. Do you buy that?
We are looking at the similarities and thinking Gunrunner, poorly realized monster.
Double dealing politicians
running. Yeah. Now that you've said that, yes, I can see the point. I think it's probably a set of subconscious tropes that maybe Robert Holmes found himself writing for a second time without realizing it. Because Androzani was obviously very much more focused and artful and brilliant. And if it was down to the strength of the storytelling, then this is a very similar story, as we've just discovered, really should have been a lot stronger. So I think he just kind of subconsciously echoed himself when he put a lot of those elements into Androzani.
One thing I noticed watching the entire series in 13 months is he was constantly recycling himself. Sharaz Jek is Magnus Greel. They have the same facial deformity, practically the same makeup, and they both use the word jackanapes. I mean, what are the odds? You spend 26 years traveling the universe with identical villains, both using the word jackanapes in the same sense to refer to the Doctor's demeanor. Robert Holmes is always bringing his stuff back. I don't think he said, let me try Power of Kroll again. I think it just unconsciously resurfaced in his writing. And because Caves of Androzani is about the Doctor's upstanding moral figure and about the tragedy of Sharaz Jek against everybody else who is unsympathetic, whereas in Power of Kroll, things just happen and you don't really get any sense of who any of these characters are, with the possible exception of the one swampy who's lost his faith and doesn't believe. I think Varlik is his name.
Oh, yes. The one who survives to the end.
Well, Skart survives too. And if you know who Skart is, boy, you're some fan.
I'll be honest. I mean, if I hadn't reread the book today, I wouldn't have remembered. I mean, I watched this one on TV less than 3 years ago, or maybe... Yeah, less than 3 years ago. I can remember really very little. So it just shows how even in the Graham Williams era, it managed to just be unmemorable rather than... And I don't want to sound like I'm beating down on the Graham Williams era, because that's where my comedy comes from. You know, that Douglas Adams, Tom off the rails kind of feeling. That's very much my wheelhouse. And I do like the era despite its unavoidable shortcomings. But yeah, this is just unmemorable, even though somehow it's got Mary Tam in it. It still manages to be unmemorable.
You have to take... It takes a lot of skill to make her unmemorable.
Right.
So, since we're coming up to the bottom of the hour, and since there's only so many times that I can say the word Skart without getting funny looks from the other room, let's talk about 20 questions. I'm going to challenge you to a game.
Okay.
I have selected at random from the internet, the randomizer.net, one Doctor Who serial, anywhere from 1963 until 2022. I don't know if Power of the Doctor has been loaded in yet, so we can assume that it's not that. But it's one other random story, anywhere from black and white to the present, HD.
Oh,
using
wow.
20 yes or no questions, you have to guess which story it is. Nobody has failed this game yet. The record is my good friend Conrad, who got it in 6, because Conrad is awesome. It is now your turn to play 20 questions. Question number 1.
Are you a new Who story?
It is not, or I should say I am not
right.
A new Who story.
Okay.
Question 2.
Are you black and white?
I am black and white, which is a beautiful segue into our conversation from earlier of being the last generation to understand black and white imagery. You might get this faster than Conrad did. Conrad, hold on to your seat. Question 3.
Are you Well, are you a Troughton?
I am not a Troughton. Question four.
Do you feature Iain Chesterton?
I do. As a human being, I feature Iain Chesterton daily. And as the answer to a trivia question, I too feature Iain Chesterton. So that is two yeses for the price of one.
Marvelous.
You have, since Iain was only in a season and a half of the show, you now have a shot at guessing the story in less than six questions and dethroning Conrad. It would take a lucky guess on question five, but you might be able to tie him. Question five.
I think I'm going to go for the lucky guess for this question, just in case it pays off, and then maybe I can come back with some more studious questioning. So it's a story with Iain Chesterton in it. It could be any story with Iain Chesterton in it. All I've got to do is try and intuit which Iain Chesterton.
I think that is 16 serials with Iain Chesterton. So you have a 1 of 16 shot right now.
Are you The Reign of Terror?
Ooh, I am sorry. I am not The Reign of Terror.
Okay.
Considering some of the life choices that I've made, you could call me The Reign of Error.
Well, like I said, we're middle-aged men podcasting about Doctor Who, so we've all done something wrong somewhere in our lives.
We have a lot of sins to atone for in the next life. Question six.
Okay, question six. Are you from series one of Doctor Who?
Now, when you say series one, do you mean the TV season or do you mean the production season? Because there's two different season ones.
Oh, the TV season.
I am from TV season one, which stretches up through the Reign of Terror, rather than production season one, which goes through the rescue. So you're now at question seven, I believe.
Are you a historical?
I am not a historical. Question eight. Now, when I played this game myself, when I was a guest on the show 2 weeks ago, I got it an eight. So you have a chance to tie me.
Right. So is that one or that one or not that one, because that was a historical. That was a historical. Could be that one. So, right, I could ask a serious question, but I'd sacrifice tying with you, or I can just throw out another guess and try and tie with you on eight. So I'm going to ask if you are the Keys of Marinus.
That is coming up on this show very soon. I love the Keys of Marinus in a way that I shouldn't, because it's pretty terrible. However, I am not the Keys of Marinus.
Okay. So... so what am I looking at? I'm looking at Daleks, Sensorites, Edge of Destruction. If only I had all the books of season one somewhere where I could see them, but I don't have them.
We're down to six serials from season one, because you've ruled out Marinus and you've ruled out the French Revolution.
Yeah.
And you've ruled out that it's not a historical, so that knocks out serial A and serial D and serial, I guess, F, if F is the Aztecs. So I think you're down to a 1 in 3 shot.
So are you the Sensorites?
I am
the
Sensorites. And as someone who thinks that is a very underrated story, I too am the Sensorites. I am the answer to the question, and I am a Sensorites guy.
Oh,
so again,
you
get two yeses for the price of one, and you got it. And it's a very respectable showing. What we are going to do now is reload the randomizer for my next guest. And I'm recording that episode tomorrow, so I pity that fool. I am now reloading the randomizer, and let's see what we get. Oh, that's a very interesting and controversial choice, and I think my next guest is going to have trouble getting that story. So, Iain, before I release you back to your four other podcasts, where can my listeners find you online, assuming they're not following you already, which they probably are?
Well, anyone who is already following me online will have noticed that I've kind of stepped back from Twitter. I'm still operating the @broadanddeep Twitter address for the Doctor Who Books podcast that I do. Otherwise, you can find me by subscribing to All of Time in Space, Strangers in Space, We're All Stories in the End, and The Electric Sodcast. Yeah,
I think that's four. And Iain, we're going to slot you back in for another appearance in about 6 months or so, and by then you will probably be up to podcast number 5. So I look forward to talking to you about your next project next time you're here.
Fantastic. Thank you very much.
Have a great night.
Take care.
Doctor Who and the Power of Kroll, written by Terence Dix, televised as The Power of Kroll, teleplay by Robert Holmes, televised in December 1978 and January 1979, published in May 1980. The huge, octopus-like Kroll lived deep in the swamps of the humid, steamy planet. To the native swamp warriors, Kroll was an angry, mythical god. To the money-grabbing alien technicians, Kroll was a threat to a profit-making scheme. In their search for another segment of The Key to Time, the Doctor and Romana have to face the suspicion of the lagoon dwellers, the stupidity of the technicians, and finally, the power of Kroll. Dump, 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 dump. The Power of Kroll is a novel in the Key to Time sequence. Also available, The Rebos Operation, The Stones of Blood, and The Androids of Tara. Coming soon, The Armageddon Factor. It's easy to overlook the novelization of The Power of Kroll. I sure did. It holds the sad distinction of being the very last of the original run of Target paperback novelizations that I ever bought. I delayed buying it as a tween in the mid-80s, probably because I didn't like the TV serial, even back then, at an age when I uncritically loved just about every other Doctor Who story. And also because after about 1985 or 86, it was increasingly hard to find on bookstore shelves in the U.S., supplanted by the newer and more brightly colored books coming out of the Peter Davison and the retroactive tide of new Hartnell and Troughton era novelizations. So, when I got to Visions 1996 in Chicago over American Thanksgiving weekend, it was down to just this and the Horror of Fang Rock novelization to complete my collection. I bought this from one of the tables in the dealer's room, and it was a first edition, a 1980 printing. Almost all my other books are 1984 vintage or later. I read the book in lightning quick time, and then put it back on the shelf, and didn't read it again for probably at least another 15 years. Not a book, I thought, that merited much critical observation or keen analysis, although that back cover blurb sure is snarky. However, looking at it now, and this audio essay is derived from a review that I wrote for the Doctor Who Ratings Guide in the summer of 2019, just weeks before Terence Dix passed away, the novelization of Kroll is deceptively terrific. You have to overlook a few things to enjoy it, of course. First, the TV story. Not Robert Holmes' best script, but you can hardly blame him, as he put all his chops into the Rebos operation, which came out just a few months earlier. The TV production benefits in part from striking location visuals, but suffers from limp acting and that Kroll prop. Oh my. Even in the context of 1978, some of that, as the discontinuity guide later called it, limp tentacle acting, beggared belief. The book dispenses, of course, with the TV visuals, which means that you lose the marshes and hovercraft and convincing green aliens on the one hand, but you also lose the woeful acting and Kroll prop on the other. All that's left are Holmes's words, and to quote an observation by Chris Bidmead, preserved on the text commentary production notes to the Castrovalva DVD release, words were Doctor Who's best special effect. And here you have Holmes's script and concepts laid bare. And who was a better world builder in the Doctor Who universe than Robert Holmes? And filtered through the crystal clear prose of one Terence Dix, who never wastes a word and never lets a sarcastic observation slip by. While the script may not be Holmes's best, Terence writes as if it is. Terence includes an epic prologue, introducing us to the Kroll creature. He gets off an impressive line on his opening page about the moon of Delta Magna, quote, "It was no place for men, but men lived there all the same. The shuttlecraft touched down on the refinery's tiny launching pad, discharged its solitary passenger with its bulging travel bag, and took off, as if it couldn't wait to get away again. It's hard to argue with that kind of prose. I love his characterization of the shuttlecraft, for example. The cast of characters in The Power of Kroll is largely made up of the most cardboard of stock characters, for whom the phrase one-dimensional would be high praise. Nobody in this story really changes, and there are only two or three proper cast members who survive anyway. Put it this way, Holmes named one of the refinery characters after that character's eventual death scream, "Harg!" and named one of the swampies Skart, which sounds awfully rude for two or three different reasons. Terence wisely introduces all the refinery characters in a single paragraph, but makes his words matter, and ties them all together with a Shakespeare quote, giving these characters a richness on the printed page that they most certainly did not deserve on videotape. Quote, "Fenner, dark, round-faced, with a look of irritable gloom, as though he had some perpetual grudge against life. Dagin, young and eager, yet with an air of nervous tension. Harg, amiable enough, but often quiet and withdrawn. Thawne himself tended to be silent and uncommunicative, so they weren't exactly a happy band of brothers." Terence also dives straight into the political subtext of the presence of this refinery on a planet that's basically a Native American, quote-unquote, Indian reservation, and there's someone who on the DVD audio commentaries typically came across as the Doctor Who production office's resident Tory, even though he wasn't, really. Terence delivers a fine and shockingly relevant piece of left-wing agitprop, commenting on the situation. Quote, "Delta Magna was their home world, a bustling, heavily industrialized planet. Reasonably Earth-like, it had been one of the first to be colonized. Now, like Earth itself, it was overdeveloped, to the point where its teeming population was running out of both space and food, hence this refinery." Terence even straight up makes note of the reservation comparison, mentioning the, quote, "Red Indians of Earth," end quote. I don't think it was okay to say the phrase "Red Indian," even in a children's book, even in 1980, although Terence used that line again the following year when the novelization of An Unearthly Child came out, in that case an exact quote from TV dialogue. When the refinery's lone swampy employee, amusingly named Mensch, the word that has strongly benevolent connotations for those of us Americans descended from Yiddish-speaking ancestors, enters the room. Quote, "None of the four men in the room spared him a glance." A few passages later, as Harg calls the swampies savages, no one so much as glanced at the swampy servant in the doorway. Terence lets you know right away that these humans aren't heroes or role models, and that the swampies have good reason to shortly start fighting back. The swampies are not simply portrayed as noble savages either. Even though they're also an assemblage of one-dimensional characters, they too, like the refinery men, are not all the same. With Rankwin, their chief, the great John Abernethy's final Doctor Who guest role, being a power-mad religious zealot, there's not much Terence can do in the page count to make most of the characters, human or swampy, more well-rounded than Holmes did in the original scripts, but at least they are playing different one-dimensional types. The rest of the novelization is Terence's usual fare, adapting the camera scripts and thrusting in barbs or covering in minor plot holes. Quote, "Several of the swampies threw spears, though luckily all missed." The text doesn't quite match the TV dialogue. The word "hell" appears here in dialogue, though it was removed before taping. There's some extra exposition left on the book that had been cut from the TV, presumably for timing reasons, such as the explanation of who Dame Nellie Melba was. I can tell you, when I first saw this on TV in the summer of 1985 at age 11, I would have had no idea who was Dame Nellie Melba, so the Doctor's explanation in the novelization was very welcome. In the book, Dagin affirmatively identifies himself as an environmentalist spy for the Sons of Earth, but the word "we" was neutered to "they" on the day of taping. Evidently, the character Skart, the swampy high priest, was not in Holmes' script for Part 4 until someone, probably the director, noticed that the character vanished and inserted him into the final installment by reassigning him lines, from other characters. Scart's not in the book, vanishing after Chapter 9 without explanation. And all the words that he said on TV, when you compare the book to the televised Part 4, that all of Scart's on-screen dialogue comes from words attributed to Rankin or Varlick in the novelization. None of the words are especially important, just like the character Scart himself isn't remotely important.
Doctor!
The fifth segment!
Oh, well done!
You killed Kroll?
With that stick?
Well, it is a bit difficult to explain.
It is rather a special sort of stick.
And by the way, the Andrew Skilleter novelization cover, which is pretty gorgeous, the smiling photo of the Tom Baker Doctor is taken exactly from the photograph of the moment on TV when the Doctor has defeated Kroll with that stick, reducing him to the fifth segment of The Key to Time. It is a much better picture than you would expect, given the quality of some of the visuals in the novelization, but it really does work on the printed page, and that is very much thanks to Andrew Skilleter. And speaking of the word picture, boy oh boy, can Terence write a death scene. Quote, Rom Dutt's nerve suddenly broke. He began sprinting desperately across the swamp, leaping from tussock to tussock, blundering in and out of mud pools, crashing through the reeds like an elephant gone berserk. An enormous gray tentacle rose out of the swamp, flicked around his waist, and plucked him out of existence. There was a dreadful bubbling scream, a squelching, sucking sound, then silence. Terence's pacing of action scenes brings me utter joy. He uses an intelligent array of words, but none longer than three syllables, and seems to perfectly match the action with adjectives, adverbs, verbs, and even a simile, and the use of the word silence to represent death. This book might have been written over a long weekend, but you could labor over rewriting Rom Dutt's death scene for weeks and not come up with a more elegant passage than this one. Really, the one part of the book which is a letdown is Terence's final sentence. The Power of Kroll was the fifth serial of the Key to Time season, with the sixth and final story coming up next. Terence doesn't often lead into the next adventure, since the books were largely published out of sequence, but in this case he notes that the search for the sixth and last segment of The Key to Time was to be the most astonishing quest of all. Well, that would not be quite the case. Come to find out. Next time on Doctor Who Literature, we wrap up our four-week season, mini-season, on The Key to Time, with the final novelization in the Key to Time sequence, the June 1980 release of Terence Dicks' own Doctor Who and the Armageddon Factor. There are, of course, two other novelizations in the Key to Time sequence still to come, and that is the David Fisher audio novelizations of Stones of Blood and Androids of Tara, which we discussed on this show last week, episode 56 with Michael Stevens. That episode was released on Christmas Day, just as this episode is being released on New Year's Day. So not all of you might have had the chance to hear it yet. I certainly encourage you to go back into my catalog and listen to my conversation with Michael Stevens in episode 56. I will be returning to the David Fisher novelizations of the two Key to Time stories when I get there in publication order. That is almost certainly at least 2 years away, if not more so. But next week, let's walk through the valley of the shadow of death. Let's streak towards Zeos, streak towards Zeos, streak towards Zeos. I am joined by a first-time guest, but one very, very well known to the Doctor Who universe, and I'm very pleased that he's chosen to join us. And that'll be next week, Doctor Who and the Armageddon Factor. Thank you for joining me on another episode of the Doctor Who Literature Podcast and the first episode of the year 2023. Special thanks to my special guest, the prolific Iain Martin. This podcast can be found on most of your podcast apps of choice. You can find all past episodes at anchor.fm/Doctor Who Lit. It really helps if you rate 5 stars and subscribe. You can find me on Twitter at Doctor Who Novels, that's Dr. Who Novels. My old tweets about the entire series under the hashtag Doctor Who Pilgrimage, that's Dr. Who Pilgrimage. My current Twilight Zone watchthrough under hashtag TZ Pilgrimage. Or you could just watch today's Sci-Fi Channel marathon of the Twilight Zone itself, the New Year's Day annual marathon. Then you can find me, as opposed to Rod Serling, on email at Doctor Who Literature. That's drwholiterature@gmail.com. Please drop me a line with your comments, questions, and suggestions. Thank you for listening. And whatever you do, keep turning the pages.
Doctor Who Podcast Network.